thank you very much, Jeff, and thank you for the invitation to be here. It's an honor indeed. My sense is that I've been asked to talk about my experiences from Pakistan in trying to institutionalize non-communicable diseases planning into public health policy. And what I thought I will do this morning is to talk about two things. The past NCD policy initiatives in Pakistan and the systemic impediments that we faced in terms of putting it on the agenda. And secondly, I would like to showcase an on-ground program which has been established by my organization, which in fact offers a research setting with many different entry points. So I'll start with the first point first, which is related to NCD policy initiatives. I think this should come as no surprise because successive demographic surveys have shown, surveillance surveys in Pakistan have shown that non-communicable diseases is a major cause of death. And this information is in the public domain. It is owned by the government. These data are gathered by a government agency. And since 1992, there is evidence of the significant magnitude of non-communicable diseases. But as opposed to this, non-communicable diseases just did not feature on the government's policy. I returned to Pakistan in 1996, and I established an organization called HeartFile, and we initially started advocating for heart disease prevention by creating public awareness and through putting pilot projects on ground and learning from those experiences. And I subsequently realized, after making many mistakes in the field, that it really wasn't within the capacity of an NGO to aim for broad-based change. So I started advocating to the government that they should put NCDs on their agenda. And initially, you know, people would laugh at me that, you know, this is something that is not relevant to the developing countries as well at all. And you're really off the mark in advocating to us about a thing that really doesn't matter to us. And I would show them data from the Pakistan demographic surveys, and they would turn around to me and say, well, why isn't WHO saying this? If these are the data that you've pulled out, and if these data are correct, why doesn't the World Bank talk about these things? Why are you the one who keeps coming and telling us these things? I really wasn't making a headway for many, many years. And then I subsequently, you know, there was leadership in the Ministry of Health at one point that could understand what I was saying. And we were able to enter into a tripartite partnership between the Ministry of Health, the local WHO office, and my NGO. And that tripartite partnership, through an official memorandum of understanding, which is in the public domain, charted a course of action for a process that would ultimately culminate in the development of a national action plan for non-communicable diseases for the country. And in my naivety, I committed pro bono time to lead that process. I really didn't know what I was getting into. I was a cardiologist trained to put catheters into people. I really had no idea what I had set myself up for. And to make matters more complicated, I agreed that in our definition of NCDs, we would not only have the four diseases that are linked by common risk factors, but we would also include mental health and injuries into that framework. And this is very much going to your point, Professor Black, about the importance of mental health and how that could not be included into the framework that was negotiated last year. So after that memorandum of understanding, we embarked on a very long journey. A process was, and for me, it was my second thesis because I learned while doing this. So I mobilized all the constituency of actors who'd been active in different NCD domains with planning bits and pieces, with gathering data. I got them on board. I created a local NCD forum. I reached out to all the experts that I knew in the international field. We created an international advisory board. There was a clear-cut process. There were terms of reference of what the NGO would do, of the way that WHO would provide support, about the role of the Ministry of Health. And we came up with priorities in each area, in each of the seven domains. And of course, research priorities were part of that. And then we spun those priorities into an integrated framework for action, where we identified that there were certain things that could be combined across the seven diseases, particularly in the realm of surveillance, integrated behavior change communication, and integration of NCDs into the work stream of primary health care. And we got a consensus on the strategies that were to be adopted. We hammered out process, output, and outcome indicators. We got clarity on the means of measuring them. And we thought we were doing very well. We grounded the plan of action in a sound conceptual theory. We had a very innovative financing mechanism in place, which brought together the contributions of various actors, you know, the bilaterals, the multilaterals, the NGO, the in-kind contributions, the government's contributions, the budgetary allocations. And over the next 3 years, we tracked that the budgetary contributions of the NGOs and the partners were going down, and the government was taking more ownership, and it looked really good from the way it was going. We had an accountability framework in place that held all actors responsible for delivering on the targets that they were mandated with. And we got the First Lady involved in that. So the First Lady was blessed this initiative. She was there on two occasions. She released at the signing of the MOU. She was there at the release of the event. She was there. We had Professor Darwin Labarthe invited. I invited him for the release of the plan, because at that time the United States was doing its own national plan for non-communicable disease for cardiovascular diseases, and of course we wanted to learn from each other. So he was there at this event. The Journal of Pakistan Medical Association did a special supplement translating the entire action plan into a set of papers, and then we went ahead with rolling out the plan. And there were four things that we did in particular. Number one, we started with population-based surveillance. We picked up a district. The government money had not been mobilized yet, so I asked CDC for money and through their BRFSS stream. And I have some very interesting stories of how the STEPS approach and the BRFSS approach were actually looking eye to eye at that time. So integrated module for surveillance, population surveillance of NCDs. We did it in one district. The World Bank subsequently analyzed it and said that it should be scaled up nationwide. At that time, my organization was also technically supporting the Federal Bureau of Statistics to develop the first compendium of health statistics for Pakistan. And we were able to articulate a set of NCD indicators to be measured alongside communicable disease indicators. Secondly, through a partnership with the private sector, we mobilized resources for an integrated behavior change communication strategy, which, in our language says, learn to live longer. So the campaign was called Learn to Live Longer. And even today, all the documentaries are on the YouTube if you go to the Heartfile website. Thirdly, in terms of actions, we developed all the tools and instruments for integrating NCDs into the work plan of lady health workers in Pakistan, which is Pakistan's field force of 90,000 village workers who deliver maternal and child health services door to door at the grassroots level in rural areas. And we got clarity on, we established baselines, we got clarity on the tools and measures. And we developed a package for district capacity building for decision makers at the district level. I thought things were going very well. And then reality hit me. Because when the government changed, the next government wanted to have nothing to do with NCDs. And all this came to a naught. The most important lessons that I have learned in my professional life are the lessons from failure. And I always put this example up, to show how a project which was ahead of its times, because we talked about the integrated approach, about multi-sectoral partnerships, about innovative financing for NCDs back in 2003, way before the political declaration was crafted. We got a government's agreement in black and white, which is still up on the web. But the next government wanted to have nothing to do with it. And I'm telling you this story to drive home the importance of a point, because this is a meeting about research and policy. And a lot of times in the developing world, research and evidence from research and the existence of policies and plans really don't mean anything, because the institutional framework to translate that evidence into practice is really lacking. Those institutional mechanisms are not there. And those accountability frameworks that can hold decision makers accountable for the actions that they take are just missing. And there's absolute lack of policy consistency. Last week, I was called to the Planning Commission because Pakistan in these days is in dire fiscal constraints. And I was asked, well, what is it that you want to prioritize? And I just told them one thing. I said, you have to prioritize a commitment to have policy consistency and to learn from evidence. And the worst reform will pay dividends. But if you don't have that, you will keep doing things every 2 years and they will never come to fruition. So I just wanted to show you this example. I've learned a lot from failures in life. And when initiatives such as this talk about research and evidence with the expectation that they will translate into action in the low and middle income countries, you have to bear in mind there are these broader brush issues which stand as systemic impediments. And unless we pay attention to those, things are not really going to transform in ways that we hope they should. The next part of my talk is about an initiative. So I've learned from I've engaged with governments heavily, and I've committed a lot of time pro bono to help plan and strategize. But at the end of it, I came to the conclusion that it's best to put something on ground and to demonstrate how it works and to structure it on the right parameters to scale it up and to use this as a setting for research and evidence generation. So something of that nature is, I have been able to put on ground something of that nature. That initiative is an initiative which ensures access of poor people to ensures their financial access to healthcare. And because NCDs is such a huge component of that, I thought I will show you a 3-minute documentary and then wrap up with a few comments with respect to how it has relevance for something that we are discussing today. So just to conclude, in environments like ours, sometimes you require to put something in place to demonstrate how things happen. And for me personally, this is at the one end a humanitarian intervention, because we always talk about health systems weaknesses, we talk about access issues, but we really do not palpate what it means at the level of a poor man, you know, when he really has to relinquish his assets or forgo care when faced with major medical expenses. And nobody works in this area because everybody wants to prioritize primary health care. Nobody wants to focus on this area of catastrophic medical expenditures. And I thought it was a humanitarian intervention that I just had to work around. But for me, it's also a development intervention because I've tried to strategically position this project in Pakistan's health system. And what I've done is that I've created a fund. I've developed a technology portal which is mHealth enabled. And then I've tried to leverage 3 strengths of the Pakistani infrastructure. One is the pervasiveness of the mobile phone. The second is the wonderful technology infrastructure that we have, which is generally unused. And the third is the capacity within the system to archive information and to stratify patients based on their economic status. And I've tried to leverage all those 3 strengths and have created a structure which is now